Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome back to the second episode of Brian Keene Live. And I am, of course, Brian Keene. It would be really awkward if I wasn't. Thanks for tuning in. As we do every week on this show, while we're waiting for folks to stagger into the chat room and tune into the chat, I like to show off cool things. However, you might have noticed it's not my usual backdrop. I'm not in my office tonight. I am, in fact, at my ex-wife's house. I am babysitting her dog and her cats while she's traveling for work. So we have this nice cat tree as my backdrop. And it occurred to me about half an hour before showtime, I don't have access to my library because it's at home and I don't have any cool stuff to show off. Enter my 14-year-old. If you listen to The Horror Show with Brian Keene, you know him as Dungeon Master 77.1. He now goes by Firelord HD, which is the name of his own channel right here on YouTube. There's a plug for him. Anyway, he stepped up and gave me something cool to show off, something he thought was cool. This is his signed edition of Clown in a Cornfield by Adam Caesar. Signed for him, personalized for him. I think it is so cool that at age 14, he's discovering authors that he really likes. He picked up Joe Hill's re-release of 20th Century Ghost. I think what they call it now, The Black Phone and other stories or something like that. He picked that up on his own. He was in an airport, saw it, bought it. He's working his way through Stephen King. He loves Adam's stuff. He loves Mike Lombardo's stuff. And it's really cool to see him read these, not just as a fan at age 14, but clearly as a 14-year-old who has the writing bug, who is going to become a writer. He's set this path already. You know, that's what he's aiming for with college, etc. So it's very cool to watch him go through that process. One author that he has not started reading yet is the multiple Bram Stoker Award, Locus Award, and British Fantasy Award winning author whose books include Survivor Song, Disappearance at Devil's Rock, A Head Full of Ghosts, The Little Sleep, No Sleep to Wonderland, Growing Things, The Cabin at the End of the World, which on February 3rd will debut in the feature film adaptation Knock at the Cabin by M. Night Shyamalan. I am, of course, talking about Paul Tremblay. What's up, brother?
Hey, I've got Adam's sequel here. If readers out there, if you've read the first one, you should also read Friendo Lives, the second one. It's not signed, though. Come on.
Is it signed to you?
It is not signed.
I hear him chuckling from the bedroom. So
is Firelord an Avatar reference? Oh, no, it is signed. I'm an asshole. Sorry.
Look at that.
I take it back. Jesus. Sorry, Adam.
No, I don't know if it's an Avatar reference or not. Yeah. It might be. I know he's a fan of Avatar.
I mean, anything Avatar related, because my kids are such fans. Like yeah. Emma, who's 18 now, of the can get tattoos on her own age, has already started filling up her body, and she's got the Tukoi fish from Avatar on her thigh.
Yeah,
and she's also she's an artist, and she already bought herself a tattoo gun to practice with and fake skin. Fake skin.
No kidding.
Weird. It is weird. It's kind of creepy. Here, it sounds like she's grinding stone upstairs because she puts it on her desk, so it just vibrates through the house.
Is it like the stuff they put on my arm when I got burned?
No. I mean, I don't think it's.
I mean, it's my real skin now, but
yeah. I mean, it's like essentially like a probably like a sheet of silicone of some sort.
Yeah.
But you know, it's just a little square rectangular. She posts it to her Instagram. Basement Sink, I think, is her Instagram handle. You can see some of her early practice tattoos.
Cool. Very cool. Everybody check that out. Well, I hate to say it's a good segue because that sounds like I'm making light and I'm not. But, you know, talking about fake skin and hospital stays, talk about our friend Laird Barron. I'm sure most of the public, most of the viewers tonight know that Laird's been sick for a while. He's been absent online. Well, he is now in the hospital. Now, Laird is a very private person, and neither Paul or myself are going to talk about everything that's going on with him. But suffice to say, the situation's dire. Like myself, Laird does not have health insurance, so there's a GoFundMe up. It's being organized by Mike Davis, Lovecraft E-Zine. All the funds go to Laird. There's the address right there, and we'll have that up on screen throughout the show. Also, if you follow me on social media or you follow Paul on social media, we have the link live on our social media as well. Paul, last week for the inaugural show, I had Stephen Kosnowski on, and we're talking about, you know, his goals, his definition of success. And as he was talking about, you know, what he thinks would be success to him, he was describing pretty much exactly where you are right now with your career. You know, you've taken a year sabbatical from teaching. But I wonder, when you see what somebody like Laird or somebody like myself goes through, you know, without having that day job, you know, to back us up,
right?
Does it give you pause about, you know, oh, I think maybe I'd better go back to work next year? Or,
no, I mean, when people ask me all the time about, like, how come you still teach? How come you still been teaching? And I've been pretty open about saying, hey, you know, it's my safety net. Like, it, you know, gives me my incredibly crappy American health insurance, you know, and my whole family too. But it's funny, like, when you're talking about the definition of success, I mean, to spin the positive sort of reaction so far to the GoFundMe, it's like, I mean, I don't know how Laird couldn't view himself as a success as a writer, you know, after seeing like how quick the number of donations has really just, you know, gone through the roof. And it wasn't surprising. Like, both John and I have sort of, and a few other people have sort of known this day might be coming, you know, because he doesn't have health insurance. And we were like, well, you know, we were like, well, at least, you know, if worse comes to worst, we don't think it'll be a problem that, you know, people are going to be willing to help Laird out.
Right.
And he is going to need help, but both, like, in terms of best case and worst case scenarios, you know, there's going to be a need for sort of continuing medical service. So, yeah. So, I mean, yeah, there's a lot of balls moving, trying to see what we can do, you know, for Laird on many different fronts. You know, much thanks and praise to Mike Davis for not only setting up the GoFundMe, but he's doing a lot of stuff, you know, setting up even like maybe even a Zoom meeting with the hospital next week to talk about things. And of course, John, who's really the only one who's, you know, been able to go to the hospital and see him and get actual information.
Yeah. Yeah. And props to both of them. And, you know, John, if you're visiting Laird and you show him this later on the phone, Laird, we love you, man. Stay strong.
Really?
You know, I always think back to, I guess maybe we'd been doing this 5-6 years, and myself, JF Gonzalez, El Marie Wood, Mary San Giovanni, we were all at a party in Washington, D.C. at a writer's house. I'm not going to say who, because I'm not sure they want their name on the air. And the four of us were in the kitchen. We were talking about Charles L. Grant, who at that time was very sick and in hospice. And we couldn't believe, new writers that we were, we just couldn't believe, A, that Charles L. Grant didn't have good health insurance, but B, that Charles L. Grant didn't have Stephen King money and couldn't just, you know, pay for all this. And Douglas Winter happened to be passing by the kitchen to get a drink, and he heard the kids in here talking, and he pokes his head in, and he points at all four of us very gravely, and he says, "Now you know what keeps us awake at night."
Yeah.
And, you know, I guess Doug was probably in his 50s at that time, and now I'm 55, and, you know, this happening with Laird, and, you know, Elizabeth Massey, we've got a fundraiser going for her as she fights cancer. I feel very much like Doug Winter. You know, it's a generational problem, and I thought maybe we'd be the generation to change it, but I don't think we're going to be. Maybe the next generation will handle it.
Yeah. So, no, for sure. I mean, not to, you know, to personalize it, but, you know, it's something I think about often as, you know, this is my first year. I've taken a year off of teaching, you know, which has been really great in a lot of ways, in most ways, you know, and I miss teaching a little bit too, but it's like, it's hard not to be like that voice in your head's like, well, what happens 2 years from now? You know, publishing careers, you know, can be and are often so fleeting. It can change on a dime. You never know what's going to happen. I know a good friend, I think, you know, Chuck Wendig as well.
Oh, yeah.
You know, something I've never forgot him say, either in an interview or just talking, he tells me, you know, because I so admire people who do make a go of it full time. It's like, you know, one thing I don't know if I can do is write with the pressure of this is all I do. Like, I mean, that's a different kind of pressure. You know, and Chuck talks about, like, for him, it's always pushing the financial cliff. He calls it the cliff, pushing it away. So 2 years down the road, if you can just keep pushing it, like 2 years down the road, that's sort of how he envisions, right, you know, like taking, you know, job X, job Y, you know, writing job, et cetera, just, you know, to keep pushing that day further and further into the future. But it's a constant push as it, look who I'm talking to.
It is. And your push goals change depending on where you're at in your career. But one thing that doesn't change is there will always be that push.
Yeah. You know?
But, you know, let's talk about that, because last time we had you on the horror show, you know, most of the success that you're now experiencing, that was really just starting to happen for you. You know, now since then, you know, you're getting interest from various filmmakers and producers. You took a week-long trip to LA during the pandemic, and you met with various movie folks. Now, I know behind the scenes how that went. I don't know how much of that we could talk about on the air, but generally, what was that experience like for you?
Yeah. So, I mean, just to be clear, it wasn't like the teeth of the pandemic. I mean, we're still in the pandemic, but yeah. Well, so yeah, that's actually this March of 21, I suppose. Yeah. With the idea that, hey, not anyone else knew that the M. Night movie was happening, but in Hollywood, it was a fairly open secret, you know, because my reps were telling people, like, hey, you know, this movie's being made, kind of thing. So I don't know, Hollywood's so strange. I mean, I've met a lot of great people, you know, and I continue, you know, I've been working with a couple of young filmmakers that really excites me, because, you know, they're so talented and smart, you know, and to me, I feel like I'm being smart because I'm attaching myself to people who are smarter than I am, which is my advice for everybody if you're going to be collaborating on stuff. But it is just such a strange, you know, not that publishing isn't strange, but ecosystem where it's like, everybody's your buddy. They tell you, like, you know, and like when you first experience, it's like, wow, like the first phone call you get with a producer or something, like, and they're talking about your book and how they want to do it. You know, you tell your wife, you tell your kids, your partner or whatever. And it's like, you never hear from them again. And that's just like, that's opposite. I don't know. How is it with adults, supposed professional adults, that ghosting is not only tolerated, but like is part of the standard operating procedure for an entire fucking industry. It's ridiculous. It's crazy.
It's maddening. And because I give, you know, zero shits these days, I have no problem calling people out. The guy that made Mandy, Panos, you know, he was all in on urban Gothic. I want to option it. I want to make it great. You know, here we got all the terms settled. Ghosted. Never heard from the guy again. Yeah. You know, it's hey, thanks. I'm glad I busted my ass, you know, doing a screenplay for it. But yeah, everybody's your friend. You know, you eat well, you eat nice while you're there. If you're a drinker, you certainly won't have to buy yourself a drink, but it's exhausting, right?
Yeah. I just finished a draft of a novel, and it's called Horror Movie and Novel. And I'm not joking. people won't see it for like 18 months, like summer of 2024. I mean, so it's definitely a horror novel. In fact, I think it's probably as grim / disturbing as Cabin in some ways. But part of it is also satires.
Right.
My experience and the experience of other writers in the Hollywood sort of just weirdness. One brief story, because it was the first call I ever took for Cabin from a producer. For some reason, like, I think because A Head Full of Ghosts made a splash. And then when there was an announcement that I signed a new book deal and that Cabin was going to be the first book of that deal. And there was a brief description of it. And actually then it was called The Four. So this was November of 2016.
Right.
I only had 50 pages at this point, but one of my reps was saying, hey, we're getting calls from producers. Do you want to take it? I'm like, it's 50 pages in a summary. I mean, do you think they would, like, yeah, you never know. So the first call I took, I don't remember the dude's name, but he was with a production company that did huge movies like Jurassic World, you know, Sully, the airplane one.
Right.
So I get on, this is my first call for Cabin. I get on the phone, and before I even say hello, I hear, hey dude, I want to be in the Paul Tremblay business. I was like, oh, what? Like another minute. It was like, is this a joke? Like, is this like a skit that I've walked into? Cause it was such a cliche. And then the phone call ended with him telling me, I haven't read everything yet. And in my head, I'm like, it's 50 fucking pages. And he says, but I'm great at guessing where this is going to go. I'm like, okay, there's going to be time travel, right? I'm like, no, there's going to be no time travel. You know, of course, you know, I've had conversations that have been very good with producers. And in fact, one of the producers who is interested, even back in 2016, ended up being the one that optioned it. Ashley Fox at Film Nation, although I think she just left Film Nation.
Right.
You know, so I have had wonderful, you know, collaborative, if not fully collaborative, but at least like communicative is a good way of putting it, you know, relationships with producers and stuff. But yeah, it's a head trip.
Good. Tom Clark on Patreon, he asks, Knock at the Cabin comes out soon. How true is it to your book? And were you involved in the project? End quote. And I want to echo that. You know, Was this a case of, here's the option money, now go away, don't talk to us, leave us alone, which happens a lot. Or were you involved? Did you get to do a set visit? Things like that.
Yeah, so I'll try to give most details or as many as I can in a brief short of time without being too boring. So it was originally, or it was optioned by Film Nation. I think verbally we agreed to it in late 2017. And then by the time the contract, you know, it takes months for the contract to get done. So it was 2018.
Right.
Yes, so we had no contractual say in the goings on. However, you know, they did treat me as sort of like a partner. And, you know, when the first screenplay came in from the screenwriters, Steve Desmond and Michael Sherman, you know, they sent me the screenplay and, you know, they asked for my input. I laughed because I gave a lot of input, you know, and to their credit, they, you know, they were still talking to me. But like anything I said was not sort of contractually bound or anything.
Right.
So fast forward a bit, you know, once it became that, oh, M. Night, you know, was going to be on at first, maybe as a producer, and then it did become him as a director. You know, he rewrote the screenplay. The first screenplay might still be available online because it won like it was on the blacklist list.
Right.
You know, so M. Night made his changes and I would say, so to answer his question, it feels like he put more of the book into the movie, especially the first couple of acts. But I would say the third act is quite different than my third act.
Yeah.
Not that I think of my books in acts, but
right.
Yeah, so people have read the book. Yeah, there'll definitely be some differences, some surprises.
Now, and, when he does a draft at the screenplay, do you give notes to M. Night or are you? Well, like-
I didn't see his screenplay until after I made the set visit. So I did get to make a set visit in May.
Yeah.
For a couple of days, and that was a lot of fun. You know, everyone was super nice. The actors were awesome. You know, I wasn't sure going on to the set, like, had anyone read the book? You know, am I just, you know, they, you know, but everyone had read the book and the actors were like really complimentary. It was really cool. You know, everyone was friendly and gracious with their time. So after the set visit, I was sent a link to read the screenplay. It was the kind of thing where, like, once you click the link, you've got like 4 or 5 hours to read it before it self-destructs. You know, the link and your laptop. So I did get to read his screenplay in one sitting.
Yeah. Did you find out if any of the actors had read the book?
Yeah, they had. At least I talked to four of the actors quite a bit. When I was on set, Rupert Grint really had already finished his work, sort of. He came in for a quick reshoot. But I spent a lot of my second day on the set visit talking to Jonathan Groff, Ben Aldridge, Nikki Amuka-Bird, and Abby Quinn.
Cool.
And they were fabulous. And they asked me some great questions about the book. And like you can tell, they really, you know, thought deeply about it. Because one of the first questions they all asked was, in your acknowledgments, you said you thanked your editor for saving you from making a disastrous decision. What was that? And, you know, so it was clear that, you know, they had spent time, you know, with the characters. And from what I could see, their performances are going to be just incredible. And that includes David Bautista.
Yeah. That's a good feeling. I always remember my set visit for Ghoul. It was clear to me on day one that none of the adults had read the book.
Mm.
Not even sure they were aware that it was an adaptation of a book. But the kids, and you know, the kids had like their own place on the set where they would go and sit, and it was supervised, and all of them had the leisure paperback and, you know, the battered, and their Nolan Gould, Jacob, all the rest of the kids are sitting there like a little book club. And man, they peppered me with questions. You know, why is this different in the book than in the screenplay?
Yeah.
Well, ask the screenwriters. Right. But it's a cool feeling.
That is cool. Now, I brought a copy cabin with me and I had, you know, most everyone sign it, which was fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very cool. Very cool. Well, speaking of books, PALLBEARERS CLUB comes out this spring in paperback, hardcover, audiobook, and ebook came out last year. Apologize for the stumbling here. The Bell's palsy's getting bad this time of day. You say in the afterword regarding the protagonist, Art, you say, quote, to be clear, Art Barbara is and isn't me. Well, fine. He's mostly me, end quote. Now, I've known you, Christ, Paul, I think almost 20 years.
Yeah.
I think as your friend in reading that book, I could see the parts of you and Art that were in there. And of course, the parts that weren't. Is it fair to say that he's the most personal character you've written thus far in your career?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, yeah. In terms of, I mean, so many of my books, you know, I don't know if you feel the same way, but like I would say all my books are autobiographical in some way.
Oh, yeah.
This one, I definitely leaned into it. I don't know, maybe too much or not. But like right before I started writing it, I don't know if I'm right or wrong, but I felt like I'd made the self-discovery that, oh, I'm, you know, because people ask you, why do you write? And why do you write horror? And so like, it's hard not like, as impossible that is to answer sometimes, you know, you spend some time thinking about it. I was like, you know, I think I started writing or I had the want for some sort of creative outlet because I'm proving to the teenager that still lives inside of me that I have something worth saying.
Right.
You know, because I didn't, you know, like so many people, you know, definitely felt like an outsider and had kind of a miserable experience in middle school and high school. So I thought, oh, maybe writing this book will help sort of release some of that. It's like, it didn't work out that way.
No?
That's fine. No. But I don't know, because I mean, it's still too much. It's so much a part of who I am. But I mean, I'm very proud of that book. It's hard not to take personally when I see reviews. People say, no, I can't stand Art Barber. He's so whiny. It's like, oh, man. But I will say. I knew he was, you know, his character was definitely over the top, maudlin. You know, so honestly, like Art's probably like 80-ish% me, and maybe Mercy is like 10 to 15% me. I know it doesn't add up to 100% because there's still, yeah. You know, the rest of it is fiction, right? You know, Mercy is often my voice of the editor, like, you know,
really,
yeah,
huh?
Like telling you to suck it up, and you know, and she needed to be there in the book to, you know, to sort of like call out Art and a lot of his own bullshit, you know.
Right.
That was part of her role, was to sort of to break that up a little bit. But I don't know. Also, at the same time, like, you know, here's Art, this character. I think clearly by the end of the book is dealing with fairly significant anxiety and depression, and it's, you know, yeah. He's hard to listen to. He's annoying because it is hard to, you know, a little bit of an empathy test. It's hard to be around someone who's depressed and anxious, and you don't know what you can do to help them.
Right.
You know, you can listen, unless you're obviously a mental health professional. I'm just saying, like, you know, as friends, I mean, you know, someone who's suffering from that, you know, and is not like full bipolar, who, you know, on medication, et cetera. You know, it can be hard to be like, not just be like, will you stop whining? Will you stop complaining? I don't know. I think it's a little bit of his character.
No,
too.
Yeah, no, I would agree. You know, I'm a fixer. I have to fix everything and make it right. And that's an incredibly hard mindset to get out of when you're dealing with somebody who does suffer from anxiety and depression.
Yeah.
You can't fix it for them. You know, yeah. Like you said, all you can do is listen and be there.
Yeah. So, I mean, all the high school stuff is pretty much true, with the exception of, I wish high school me had a friend like Mercy, except for the vampirism part. Yeah. That probably wouldn't have been cool, but, yeah, the split, you know, happened in college because I didn't drop out of college, obviously. But
right,
yeah.
Were there parts in earlier drafts where in rereading it, you're like, oh no, I went too deep. This is too personal, and you cut it out.
Yeah, I wasn't afraid of the too personal side, but I definitely cut a lot of stuff out because the challenge for me was, wow, this bit's really clever because this takes something autobiographical but twists it. But like, who the hell else is going to know that that's an actual autobiography? You know, who's going to know what that's referencing?
Right.
So the hard part became, okay, what's going to work? What's going to work for the story? You know, what has to be there for the story? For, you know, obviously someone who isn't me reading this. So more than pretty much any other book, with maybe the exception of Disappearance of Devil's Rock, the draft I turned in, I ended up cutting 10,000 words, 30 pages-ish.
You know, wow.
Yeah. Only one of it was like a plot thing, like a scene that was really cool, but it just didn't work. It would have messed with the logic of sort of the vampirism rules that were sort of, were there or were not there.
Right.
But yeah, a lot of it was I did cut a bunch of his whinging out.
Yeah. Do you save that stuff?
I do. Yeah. Yes,
why?
I don't know. Like for that one, it felt hard to cut out because it was so personal. And part of me is like, oh, if I do a limited, I'll put that back in. But like, I'm not going to put it back in. I don't think.
Like, well, works better put it in at the end of the limited.
Yeah, yeah. Like, I would definitely include. There's a scene that takes place with some marble lions. But again, I thought it was like a cool set piece,
right.
But it didn't make sense really in the rest of the book, so I had to go. So yeah, I would include something like that in the if there's a limited, and I think there's going to be. Yeah. There will be from SST.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, in that same vein of too personal, not personal enough, in his review for the Washington Post, Paul DeFilippo says, he's talking about art. He says, quote, "It's an intricate portrait of a man who is full of potential, desire, and talents, but who ultimately betrays himself by a not so subliminal desire for failure," end quote. Do you think that's autobiographical? Do you secretly desire failure?
I think that's the fear. I don't know. I mean, so obviously I haven't put that into motion yet.
Right. Yeah. Because if so, you suck at it.
Yeah. I haven't named all names yet. Right. No, I mean, Paul's so smart. I mean, to me, the fun part is like, as a writer, I'm sure you've experienced this too, we trust our subconscious when we put stuff in. Now, I like to think, but at the end of a book, like I have to be able to explain to myself why something is there. Like, not necessarily in words, but like every sentence I can be to myself, okay, this is why this had to be here and not be cut away. When you have something, when Paul writes something like that, it's like, I don't know if I was necessarily thinking that, but that makes sense to me now that he said it. And that's really cool. Like when other people can point stuff out to you about what you wrote.
That's why we all want Paul to review every book.
Oh, he's amazing. Yeah, right? For sure. Yeah.
Making great. I do want to talk about, and I can see you tensing up already. I want to talk about what happened with the initial Kindle edition. Because as you know, behind the scenes, I was ready to burn the industry down on your behalf. So for folks watching who have not yet read the book, the book is supposed to be this found manuscript. It's art's memoir. Yeah. But this memoir has been annotated and amended by the antagonist who Paul mentioned, Mercy Brown. Yeah. Her parts are in red ink. Now, if you read it in hardcover like I did, it's very fascinating. It's effective. But that format did not lend itself to Kindle reading. And when the book launched, show them, Paul.
So this is the ARC, so it doesn't have the red ink, but like it's got, notes in the margins and stuff.
Hang on, I'm going to take myself off screen for a second so they can see it better.
Yeah, so we mentioned Art Barbara is the main character who writes the book, and then the other character, Mercy Brown, comments on Art's manuscript because she finds it.
Right. Yeah, so, it comes out on Kindle. None of that translates well on Kindle. And it's not your fault, but suddenly you got just hammered with all these one-star reviews, not for your writing, but for the presentation problems. I mean, I can't even imagine how frustrating that has to be as an author. How did you deal with that?
Yeah, it was super frustrating. I mean, because, the day it came out, I was driving either to New York City or driving from New York City to Pennsylvania. So like,
yep.
I'm finding out about this as like I'm on the road, like trying to talk to my agent. And I missed 100 turns, ended up in like rural Pennsylvania. I had to pee so bad, dude. I'm gonna admit some public urination here. Like I couldn't make it. Thank God I had an empty bottle of Gatorade in the car. I pulled in behind some sketchy looking, I don't know if it was a church of some sort, but I had to go. But anyway, yeah, that was like par for the course. That was like the smallest problem of that day. The frustrating part for me was it's easy for me to say, cause I don't know how much work it is behind the scenes to create eBooks, to do all the stuff that the publisher that I sort of take for granted.
Right.
Someone who has a big publisher that they do all this stuff for you, which is a lot of work. With that in mind, I want to throw a plug out for, the union workers at HarperCollins who are currently on strike. I think they're almost to day 50 and HarperCollins has not come back to the table yet. You know, you can look for ways to support those workers. You know, they have an Instagram set up, you know, at HarperCollins Union. So
absolutely. Solidarity.
Right. So the frustrating part with me was like conversations that I'd had about, like, even from like when I pitched the book, like I said, hey, here's 30 pages in a summary. There's going to be like a weird, you know, there's going to be a high ask for interior design. And we're and I said this in April of 2020, or May of 2020 is when I sold the proposal. Like, we're probably going to have to do something different for the ebook, you know.
Yeah.
I know you're not going to be able to do the margins. But then they, you know, much to William Morrow's awesomeness, like, and my editor's awesomeness, like, oh, we're going to do red ink. I never asked for red ink because I knew that would have been more expensive. I was like, that's amazing. You know, that's so cool. And, you know, they really nailed the interior design. And at one point, you know, I was told, hey, we found a way to replicate this in the ebook. I'm like, you did? And I never asked further. I should have said, hey, can you send me a Kindle file so I can just take a look, which I probably should have done. You know, so what they ended up doing was just making the pages like almost like static images to replicate everything that was on there. But because that was the case, you couldn't resize. You couldn't read it. Yeah. So it was very frustrating. Yeah, there's a lot of back and forth. And my agent has been a hero for me really for forever. But, you know, this past year, man, he's been through the ringer just between asks with my publisher and asks with Universal, et cetera. You know, he's really put in a lot of extra hours on my behalf. So
give him a shout out. Give him a shout out.
Barbara, man, he's the best.
Yep.
Yeah, so many ways I'm so lucky and fortunate and privileged. And one of them is that I've had the same agent since 2006. And I know that's incredibly rare for people to have, you know, agents. You know, think of any big writer you can think of, and that I can think of all had different agents or multiple agents. And you know, my mentor Stuart Anand had 7 different agents for his first 7 books. but yeah, anyway.
So, all right. Another question from patron Mr. Macabre asks. He says, oh, he wrote an essay here, Paul.
He says, I'm lab, so yeah, go ahead.
He says, horror is a genre like no other. The fan base is rabid, no pun intended. The dedication is uncanny. What makes us so enamored with the monster, murder, and downright macabre? I've already asked Keene this. Now I pose this question to you, Mr. Tremblay. Why horror?
Oh, man. I mean, I think it's different for everybody, right?
Yeah.
I don't know why horror. Like, for me, and I'm sure it probably is for you too, like, I'm to the point where it's like, well, why not horror? Like, why aren't you a horror fan? Like, because for me, as far back as I can remember, I've always been drawn to it and totally terrified by it.
Yep.
Right. You know, my first movies, you know, that I remember watching at home was like when I was 7, 8, 9 years old, was Creature Double Feature on our local UHF Channel 56, where, you know, the first movie was Godzilla or Gamera. You know, and that's really what brought me, because I was a dinosaur kid, as so many of us were.
Right.
And the second movie was a horror movie. It was, you know, they're usually bad ones, but I didn't know they were bad. Like, you know, Attack of the Giant Leeches, Attack of the Killer Shrew, anything with Attack in the title. But those gave me nightmares. Those terrified me. I still vividly remember some ridiculous Attack of the Killer Shrew nightmares, but, you know.
Oh, for me, my gateway was comic books. But then it was, you know, Jaws and The Omen and Phantasm, but lots of terrible movies like The Car, which, you know, as you said, I didn't know it was terrible. And I still, as a 55-year-old adult, if I'm out late at night walking one of these rural Pennsylvania backwoods roads, and there's car headlights on the horizon, I have to fight the urge to go hide in the woods till the car goes past. I mean, that movie messed me up.
Oh, for sure. So, I mean, maybe like the broader answer to his question is like, why horror? Like, for me, like, my favorite horror I find is like really truthful in some ways. Or maybe I should say that the idea that someone else made this and they find it scary, like, oh, you feel like this too. Like, you're scared. It makes it not necessarily okay, but okay.
Yeah.
Like there's other people that feel like I do, that, yeah, you know, this is a scary thing that we're all going through. And I find comfort in that. And, you know, the people who aren't horror fans, I think that's the thing I notice about them, is that, you know, they don't like being confronted with sort of the scary, you know, not making a moral or personal judgment on them. You know, some of them are great people that I've worked with and I consider friends. you know, they just like, I don't want, you know, I don't want that in my life. I'm like, oh, I need that. Cause I, you know, it doesn't feel like an explanation, but again, it feels like someone's recognizing a recognition of the scariness of everyday life.
Exactly. I think that's a great answer. All right. Well, folks, we're coming up. We've got about 20, 25 minutes left in the show. So we're going to head over to your questions now. So start typing them in the comments. I can't promise you we'll get to every question, but we'll get to many as many as we can while you're typing them. Next week, next Wednesday, 8 o'clock, Cynthia Paleo is our guest. Yeah, right? You know, one of the things I want to do with this show, there are so many people like Cynthia and Haley Piper and Christopher Triana, our pal John Langan, just, you know, for one reason or another, during our 5.5 years on the horror show, I was just never able to get them on. You know, either they were just starting out or, you know, like in John's case, we just never got our schedules to sync. So,
because you were always doing it in person.
Yeah, exactly. You know, so I want to, now that this is, we're doing it like this, it's open to everybody. And yeah, so I'm excited to finally, you know, Cynthia's first sit down with me. 2 weeks from now, two Wednesdays from now, Josh Mallerman and his fiance Allison versus me and my fiance Mary Sangiovanni. We are playing the newlywed game. Nice. Folks, you are the participants. You're going to ask us the questions. Josh and Allison are going to be on one camera. Mary and I are going to be on the other camera. We're going to hold up our answers. At the end of the hour, whichever team scored the most points, we will give $100 to the charity of our choice. I'm not sure who the charities are yet. Josh hasn't picked his, but it's going to be a lot of fun. But
it's amazing.
We'll need questions from the audience. So, all right. Well, speaking of questions from the audience, let's go to the audience. I'm going to scroll up here. Lots of hellos. Hello, hello, hello. Carver Pike is watching us from the hospital in Charlton. Oh, well, you tell Jules that we're sorry to hear her mom's in the hospital. Hopefully the Wi-Fi kept up so he saw this. The legendary Scott Edelman in the house. Hello, Scott.
Hey, Scott.
Scott's somebody else who I want to get back on. Of course, we had him on the podcast many times, but I could just talk to Scott every episode.
Yeah, and Scott, not weirdly enough, but like, you know, Scott does his podcast where he's eating with writers. Actually, I ordered from the same Mexican place tonight that I had ordered for Scott and I's virtual dinner chat.
Awesome. Mike's here joining us. Ramsey Campbell had to get a job at a bookstore about 15 years ago or so. Yeah. Got one of his best novels out of it, in my opinion. But yeah, it sucks that had to happen. All right. The screen just refreshed. Let me find the questions. Good point there.
Indeed.
Hang on. All right. Here we go. Noyge Loverlord asks, so when is the contest of take a picture with Paul Bearers Club and win contest going to happen?
That's a good idea.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yeah, I'll definitely do that for the paperback release, which is going to be in mid-May. So I'm going to write that down so I don't forget.
I think so.
It's like that now. I used to be able to just remember everything. He's sort of referencing, we did a contest way back in the first iteration of the Kingdom for No Sleep to Wonderland.
Yep.
We had a contest of people taking pictures. Yep. I can't remember if it was him, but somebody took a picture laying in a coffin with it.
I don't remember if that was him or not.
Yeah. I know Matt Blasey took a picture outside, like covered in snow.
Yeah.
Yeah, there were some fun pictures.
JR asks, what do you read to get inspired, Paul?
Yeah, I mean, I try to read, you know, as fairly widely as I can. And I find like inspiration from just about everybody. But it's funny, like this past year, I've been in a fun position. I'm sure Brian's in this similar or same one, just getting asked to blurb read a ton. You know, and I try to fulfill as many as I can. But I think I did 25 this past year, which is a little absurd.
Wow.
I don't mean absurd like in a mean way, but it's like, what's the value of my blurb if there are so many of them out there kind of thing. So I'm trying to cut back a little bit. And also because I'm going to gear up for a new book and I know I need to do some reading research for that.
Yeah.
But I mean, from contemporary writers, I like to dip into stuff that people don't call horror, but actually is. You know, I feel like there's a lot of quasi mainstream literary fiction that's really dark, but that you never call it horror. I'm thinking of something like Matt Johnson wrote a book that's more science fiction than horror, but it's pretty horrific too. It's called Invisible Things.
Oh, yes.
And he's one of the funniest bastards on Twitter as well. Highly recommend. I think he got his MFA with Victor Laval and Sarah Langan. I think all three were classmates at one point. You know, talk about an amazing set of students there. Holy shit.
Talk about a novel in the making right there. Yeah,
one of my favorite writers. Oddly enough, you know, I'll throw this out there. This isn't just a plant, but I'm actually rereading John's The Fisherman.
Yeah.
Because I've been in a little bit of a reading rut. So I figured the best way to pull myself out of it, would be to reread something. And I haven't reread that one yet. So
I found last year I was returning to reread a lot of old favorites. You know, sometimes third or fourth read for me. You know, I don't know if it was something in the air or something with my creativity, but I felt like revisiting some of that. And boy, it was fertile ground creatively. It really kicked something off inside. You know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Ryan asks, for Paul, what book would you suggest someone start with if they haven't read yours yet?
Yeah, probably Headful of Ghosts, I think. I think it's fairly accessible. I think it's a cool, fun, and hopefully creepy, scary story. I think it's a nice sort of encapsulation of sort of what I try to do with most of my books in some form or another.
I'm going to throw a shout out there for Survivor Song as well. That's my favorite of your horror stuff. It's my favorite. In the Meantime, it's probably still my favorite, but for your horror stuff, Survivor. Yeah. Survivor Song, but yeah, Headful of Ghosts, definitely accessible as well. Regina asks, how do you approach the task of learning something new when required for a project?
Oh, kicking and screaming. I hate research. You know, I went to school for math, so like I wasn't an English major or history major. Like, no one really taught me how to do research. I went to public high school and did papers for those, but like, honestly, I ended up doing like the same paper on The Hobbit or Edgar Allan Poe, maybe like 3 or 4 years in a row. Sorry, I'm admitting that publicly. That's terrible. But so I guess the short of it is I have anxiety when it comes to research because I feel like I don't do it well. But I mean, it's inescapable. So my favorite way to do that though is maybe listening to like nonfiction audiobooks, which I do a lot when I'm walking my dog. And I've found that like, I'll end up doing research beforehand and maybe it's because it's in there and now I can think about the book and that, I'm thinking of this because of Survivor Song. I had maybe like a year or two before I even thought of the book, I had listened to Rabid, a natural history about the disease, I think is the title of the book. Right. Fascinating book on rabies. Everyone knows a little something about rabies, but holy crap, I didn't know, I didn't know most of it.
Right.
So when the idea for Survivor Song hit, like, I was like, oh, it's going to be super rabies. It's going to be perfect. It's going to be exactly what I need.
Anne asks, my mother is from Dijon, France, and she saw Paul Tremblay's name on a book cover. So she wants to know what part of France Paul's family came from.
That's funny. Yeah, I'm not sure. Like my paternal side of my family is very French Canadian. Like almost so much so that like I think my grandfather married his cousin, like kind of close French Canadian family. And the story was like 7 Tremblay brothers came over to Canada at some point. So I actually haven't traced back to France. I do know there's a lot of Tremblay stuff in northern France, but that's about it. I haven't done like the DNA tests. I don't know. I tend not to be paranoid, but I get a little paranoid about the DNA thing.
You know, I swore I would never do one of those because I'll admit it, I am paranoid about that stuff. But then my mom and my sister went ahead and did it.
Yeah.
So now my DNA is out there. But we actually found out, we knew we were mostly from Ireland and we still are mostly from Ireland. But apparently we go farther back than the Celts. We're like the Picts, you know, who were there beforehand. And also a surprising amount of Neanderthal DNA, which I guess explains this forehead right here. But Wes Southard. Hey, Wes. And Wes says, tell everyone how much you both love Mayflies.
I mean, it's definitely an experience. Like, I would recommend it once. I don't know if I would want to, like, have to deal with that all the time.
So, yeah, what Wes is talking about, folks, Mary and I, of course, we live right on the banks of the Susquehanna River in Pennsylvania. And every year, it's supposed to happen in May, but because of global warming and climate change and everything, it's happening later in the season. Now it's late June, early July. For a week, these flies from hell hatch. And they swarm they swarm so badly that our roads get shut down. They shut down the bridges that span the river because drivers can't see to drive. And Paul had the unfortunate luck to visit us once during Mayfly Week.
I never got to meet the Mayfly Princess or the Mayfly Prince, just, you know, thousands upon thousands, millions of giant, at least they didn't bite flies.
I'm thinking of poor Wes. You know, Wesley moves out here to, you know, he meets his wife who lives here in town, and he moves out here to be with her, and he comes to the house for Mayfly season. He's out in the backyard like in a horror movie.
Well, man, like, I was blown away by the pictures of the river frozen, like those big chunks of ice.
It
was
it wasn't bad this year. Was it last year or the year before? We actually had a wall stretching across the river. It looked like the wall from Game of Thrones. You know, I mean, it's exactly what it looked like. Wow. But yeah, this year wasn't too bad. But it's creepy at night or early in the morning to go out there and listen to the ice moving and creaking and crunching up. Huh. All right. Chris has a question regarding the PALLBEARERS CLUB. How will the red ink be handled in the paperback? That's a good question.
Yeah. So no red ink in the paperback. I mean, the design will be there. It'll just be black ink. Everything will be black ink. So, yeah. I mean, there's plenty of hardcovers still left. So if you really want the red ink, you know, those will be out there. If not, like, remaindered soon, you can pick up some cheap copies.
Speaking of plenty of hardcovers left, Paul Goblish from Books in the House. He's got copies of The Little Sleep and No Sleep to Wonderland, signed limited edition copies in stock. So go to thunderstormbooks.com.
Absolutely gorgeous.
Yep. Oh, beautiful limited editions. Noid says it was him who won the contest and got the autographed copies.
That makes sense. He would ask about pallbearers. That's why I thought, you know, I thought, oh, like, he's maybe has the coffin ready. Yep. For the pallbearer picture. Yeah.
Let me check the time. All right. We got time for a few more here. Vampire Kiss 6661 asks, when it comes to getting published, would you recommend querying an agent publisher or self-publishing through a site such as Amazon?
Well, I mean, I guess it depends on what your goal is, right? I mean, if you want to, you know, publish with the big five, you kind of have to have an agent. You know, so what you want from it is different. You know, I have no experience with self-publishing. You know, again, I was sort of joking earlier about, like, taking for granted what my publisher does, you know, which is a good thing because I'm not tech savvy. Like, the only skills I have is I can write a little bit, I can teach math, and I can shoot the three-pointer. That's all I can do. I can't keep myself alive in any other way. I can't make ebooks. So I know self-publishing is not for me. You know, I will say, like, when you go the agent route, though, you know, you just have to prepare to be patient. That'd be my, you know, writers ask for advice. I think the only advice that I have that's worth giving is give yourself permission. And I know it's impossible to when you see everyone on social media talking about all the cool things that they're doing or what they might do, is to be patient. You know, and again, that's me talking from sort of a privileged side of someone who had a stable day job that afforded me the ability to be patient. But I don't know how you felt, like, again, wasn't trained in writing. So, like, the first things I wrote was like, this was a lot of hard work. Why did I do this? But at the same time, I was like, I'm not giving this away for free. Exactly. I don't care if it's $5. Someone's going to pay me for this, or I'm going to put it away. That's kind of how I always felt about everything I wrote. And I always, even like the earliest, crappiest, terrible stories, I don't know. Partly it's because I didn't know any better. I always sent to the highest markets first.
Yep.
When they said no, then I would actually just go down monetarily. And if I got to a certain point, I was like, I knew the story was just banging its head against the wall. I put it away. You know, if I ever went back to it later, maybe I did, or if not. But that's sort of how I approached it.
Yep, same here. I would always submit to Playboy first, because back in the day, Playboy paid the most money. And, you know, when they invariably rejected it, you know, then it was Twilight Zone or Omni. And when they invariably rejected it, hi, Alan, love you if you're watching, you know, that it was Chismart CD, and Rich still has some of those early submissions. I still have some of his early rejection letters, but yeah, you work your way down until, you know, you got paid $5 for a copy. You know, my experience, I've written for the Big Five, self-published, I've written for the indie press. But I would echo what you said. If you want, figure out what you want to do with your book. And if you feel it should be with one of the Big Five, then yeah, you're absolutely going to have an agent. If you want to go indie press, as a general rule, you don't need an agent, although some indie presses are now starting to require it. And if you want to self-publish, you know, you can do that. But if you're going to do that, I would caution you, you need to hire a professional copy editor, and you need to pay people some money to give it an advance read. You need to hire a professional designer, a professional cover designer. It's a lot of work. And I speak from experience on that. But yeah, at the end of the day, you know, if you want Big Five, you need an agent. And as Paul said, you've got to be patient. Mary Sangiovanni, my beloved, in 5 months, my wife, she has written what I absolutely believe is the best novel of her career. The best novel of her career. It's a haunted house novel. That's all I'm going to say. She's got blurbs from Laird. Did you give that one a blurb?
Haunted house novel.
You know, it's been making the rounds agent wise to the Big Five for, I think, 2 years now. Mm-hmm. That's the difference between me and Mary. After 4 months, I've been like, no, fuck that. I need to get paid. I worked 4 months on that book. I've got this other book. I would have put it out already. So yeah, you've got to have patience.
Yeah. But you also have, what are you closing on 30 years in the business? And I mean, you have
25,
you have the things set in place that allows you to put something out yourself much easier than, you know, that somebody else is just starting out.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I'm speaking from a place of enormous privilege when I say that. Yeah, absolutely. All right. Carver asks, okay, so Carver, obviously the Wi-Fi is still working at the hospital. Since becoming more popular or well-known, have you had an idea for a book that you knew you just couldn't write because it would be too much for your readers? And given what Carver is known for, he's one of the new generation of splatterpunks. I feel this question, Carver. Paul, go ahead.
No, I never thought it'd be too much for my readers. I had an idea that I've mentioned to a few writer friends that I'm not gonna write, but I'm not gonna write it because I don't think it's my place to tell that story, kind of thing. But I don't think it would be too much for the readers. I think, you know, I think a woman should write that novel, you know, for example, as opposed to me, based on the subject matter of it. So that's as close as I've come to be like, oh, and again, it's like a very loose idea. So I didn't go very far into it. It was more like a vampiric concept. But yeah, otherwise, like, and I've been very lucky that I've never had any pushback on content that I've submitted to William Morrow. Like, the book that received the least amount of edits was The Cabin at the End of the World.
Yeah.
Given the violence and stuff that happened in that book, you know, they never blanked or never once said, hey, you have to change this. I don't know. I mean, I've been very lucky that it's just like, I'm just, my main question is this a book I would want to read? That's kind of my guidepost.
I don't know that I've ever thought, you know, would this be too much for my readers? But I have definitely noticed as I get older, I'll ask myself, is this too much for me? And I always use a Serbian film as an example. Had I been, you know, I was in my 20s when the video store was the big thing. And, you know, I rented Faces of Death, Traces of Death, you know, Bad Taste, every one of the, you know, Cannibal Holocaust, Eaten Alive, every one of those movies that was too much.
Yeah,
I rented and I ate it up in my 20s. But as a father, you know, I always remember we're driving in the car. Mary and I were up front, and Jesus Gonzalez and director Mike Lombardo were in the back. And Mike was in his 20s at the time, and he's raving about a Serbian film, and he's describing it, you know, plot point by plot point. And yeah, I'll never forget, Jesus and I, we looked at each other in the mirror, and we both just had these horrified looks on our faces. You know, that imagery that he described in that film, that was not something either one of us as parents needed to have in our heads. Now, were I Mike's age? Yeah, I'd have been all over that movie. Oh my God, this is the greatest thing ever. But, you know, your comfort zone and your own personal mores, I think they change depending on where you're at in life. So my question a lot is this too much for me? I found with Suburban Gothic that, yeah, this is too much for me. I need to bring in somebody else who's not such a wimp to do some of the heavy lifting. So I brought in Brian Smith, who just, you know, he doesn't care. But yeah, that's a good question, Carver.
It's interesting. Yeah, I mean, I tend to be kind of wimpy when it comes to gore anyway. I mean, so my younger brother, he was 5 years younger than me, but like he watched Texas Chainsaw Massacre when he was like 10 in fifth grade. I watched it for the first time in my 30s. and again, that's by reputation because it's pretty much a bloodless film, and it's an amazing film. It's actually one of my favorites and partly inspired the horror movie, a novel book that I wrote. I don't know. I haven't had that occur to me. I mean, because I don't think I ever would have watched Serbian film. I certainly would have watched it in my 20s. I've actually become a little bit more adventurous as I've gotten older.
Yeah.
I have found like there's some violent stuff, like head stuff really bothers me, and it didn't used to. Like the Game of Thrones scene where, was it the Viper? Is that his name? The Asp or whatever? He got his head squished.
Oh, yes. I remember that.
That really bothered me, like viscerally, like no other scene had. And partly maybe it was because, you know, credit to the show for being so, for, you know, for myself for being so like caught up in that character and wanting, you know, rooting for him, but also, you know, had some sort of emotional stake in his character. And it was just so horrible.
Right.
I don't know.
All right. Well, I think we're coming up on 9 o'clock, and Paul, I promised you an hour, so we're going to let you head out. One more time, I want to remind folks about Laird's GoFundMe. There's the address. And as I said, if not in a place where you can jot it down, Paul has it on his social media. I have it on mine. I speak from personal experience as somebody who's been in this situation with no health insurance. You know, even if you just contribute $5 or $10, it makes an actual difference. It really does. So, you know, we hope you'll do that. And if you don't have the means, that's okay. If you can share the link, promote it, let other people know what Laird's going to, you know, and convince them to help out, we'd appreciate it.
Absolutely.
And Paul, I appreciate you coming on. Knock at the Cabin in theaters February 3rd. And of course, as we said, PALLBEARERS CLUB, the paperback's coming in April. It's up for pre-order right now from your favorite bookseller. Next week, Cynthia Paleo. And in 2 weeks, Josh Mallerman and Allison Laca. Paul, we'll see you soon,
brother. Thank you, Ryan.
All right. Pleasure. Peace.